Normally I go through the slides clicky, 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 but y'all have already seen this one, so I'll just, there's no suspense, let's put the whole thing up. This is, we stopped at the end of the statement, this lemma. I wanted to go back and go through it, get it fresh in the mind again before we go through the proof. So the setup is that we have a transitive group. It has a normal complete block system with m blocks of prime size p. Here, p being the prime is needed. If p is not prime, there's a version of this that holds, but I have to throw extra hypothesis in. So this only works all the time if you have blocks of size p. I'm going to define a relation on the blocks by two blocks are related if and only if. Whenever you take anything that fixes each block setwise, and it's a p-cycle on one block, it's a p-cycle on the other block, and vice versa. So the idea here is if two blocks are related, is that if it does something on one block, it pretty much has to do exactly the same thing on the other block. And if you want, you can only think in terms of elements of order p. So if it's an element of order p here, it's an element of order here. On the other block, and vice versa. We talked last time that this relation is an equivalence relation, and I'm going to let E sub C be the union of the blocks that are contained in one of the equivalence classes. And remember that this equivalence relation is an equivalence relation on blocks, so it gives you a block in the quotient, but it doesn't give you one in the, won't necessarily give you a block in the in the set G axis. And we're going to let E be all the union of all these equivalence classes. So the lemma is that if you have, if gamma is a digraph, G is contained in the automorphism group, the setup is just like as above. We let the equivalence relation to script E be defined as it was. Then script E is a complete block system. And this is, in some senses, pretty innocuous. It's very nice. But that's not what the important thing is. The important thing is that if you take any element that fixes each block setwise, then the restriction to a block is contained in the automorphism group for every E and E. And again, remember, I'm a little schizophrenic. My restriction here is the proper restriction of homomorphism into the symmetric group on P, whereas here the domain is different, so I do the natural thing. It's defined to be the same as G inside the block, this E, and outside the block it's going to be the identity. All right, so where we want to really pick up today is with the proof of this. There's two parts. There's the proof sort of the less exciting part that script E is a complete block system. We'll do that first, and then we'll do this. The proof that script E is a block system is not bad. We're just going to show that our equivalence relation is a G congruence. And remember what that means. Well, we have to show that B is related to B prime if and only if G of B is related to G of B prime. All right, so and that will do it by lemma 41. Y'all remember that? The equivalence classes of a G congruence form a complete block system. Okay. To show it's this relation is a G congruence, I want to remind you of something. And as we go through the rest of the lectures, this fact is going to be used sort of more and more. You've probably all seen this. I saw it as an exercise in Hungerford when I took algebra. So this is not a deep fact. But if you have a P cycle, and there's nothing special about the P here, if you have any cycle and you conjugate it by G, then what happens to the elements of the cycle if you start with A0 through AP minus 1, you just get G of A0 through G of AP minus 1. How should I say, the proof of this is actually very easy if you do it right, and it's sort of completely mysterious if you don't do it right. And the right way to do it is, let's just see what happens to g of a zero when we apply g inverse m of g to g of a zero. We apply g inverse first, so we get a zero. Then we apply gamma. Gamma takes a zero to a one. And then we apply g, and so we get g of a zero. Very easy, very nice. Same argument works for all the others. So if I conjugate, what happens to the image of the orbit is it's mapped to the, what happens to the orbit is it's mapped to the image of the orbit. So one thing this tells us is that if B are these P points, then G gamma G inverse certainly permutes G of B. And I'm actually thinking a little bit more precisely here. I'm thinking of, what, if I restrict to a block and then conjugate, then that will in fact permute the points in G of B. Okay, so let's do the computations. This is again another one of these things where you do the computation and you're done. So B is related to B prime if and only if, and what I have here is just the definition. Gamma acting on B is a P cycle if and only if gamma acting on, oh, the prime's in the wrong place, is a P cycle. Okay? Now the prime miraculously gets in the right place. So this happens if and only if g gamma g inverse of g of b is a p cycle, if and only if g gamma g inverse of g of b prime is a p cycle. So all I'm doing is using that observation that if you have an orbit of gamma, you conjugate it, then that gets mapped. The elements commuting are just the image of g. And that just says that g of b is related to g of b prime. We have g congruence. Now the rest, I think everything we've done is sort of, you just do the computation and you're done. This is the first part where maybe you have to think a little bit. So I'm mainly going to do this proof by picture because I think it'll be a lot easier. This picture is supposed to represent, you can probably figure it out. Guess what the big E represents? This represents one of the big equivalence classes, E. This represents a different one. Now, each E or E prime is a union of a bunch of blocks of B. So sitting inside of each big E, there's going to be some blocks of B. Now, I'm going to sit here and yap like there's lots of blocks of B contained in E, but it's certainly possible that there's just one block. Okay, so that's what this picture is supposed to represent. All right, what am I going to do next? I'm going to choose a gamma that's in the fixer. Gamma restricted to B prime is a P cycle, and gamma restricted to B is not a P cycle, and so I can raise it to a power negative 1. So I'm going to, basically what I'm thinking about is what happens if this B and that B prime are not related. If they're not related, I'm going to be able to find such a gamma, and this is going to give us quite a bit of graph structure. All right. Right, I put these little things in here. One, somewhat shockingly, is supposed to represent that it's the identity over here. This little circle thing is supposed to represent that I have a P cycle. And remember that if you have a P cycle, it's going to be permuting all of the points. And so I'm going to think of these points as arranged in the obvious order. That point represents the first element of my P cycle. That one's the next, the next, the next, the next. Okay, so choosing gamma that is a P cycle on that block, not a p-cycle on that block, would give me this picture. Notice I have these question marks here. What that represents is that at least at this point in time, I'm not commenting about what happens on the other blocks. It's not hard to see, though, and you don't have to see because we won't need this, but just to fill out the picture. All of these are going to have to be the identity because E is an equivalence class, and all of these are going to have to be P cycles on these other blocks. Okay? And again, I don't need that. All I'm really going to be doing is playing with this block B and this block B prime. Now, remember, we've got a graph lurking in the background. One of two things now happens. There is either an edge between B and B prime, or there's not. Okay? If there's not, there's not. If there is, that means that some vertex of B is adjacent to some vertex of B prime. So I've got an edge. Okay? What am I going to do now? I'm going to apply gamma. And remember, I've adopted this convention that when you write down the P cycle over here, this is the first point, that's the next one, that's the next one, that's the next one in order. So when you apply gamma, what happens over here is that this point stays fixed, but the edge, the other endpoint of the edge moves down to the next one. And then you apply it again and again and again. And what you get is that this vertex of over here is actually adjacent to every vertex in B prime. So if some vertex of B is adjacent to some vertex of B prime, we now have that that vertex is adjacent to every vertex of B prime. Okay? Now I'm going to choose a different element. I want to make sure this time that what I have is a P cycle over here. And I don't care what it does anywhere else. But I do want to make sure that it is in the fixer, so it fixes each block. Okay? Well, what will happen now? Well, what happens to this picture here? I've got every edge, so every one of those is an endpoint, so every one of those is still going to be an endpoint, regardless of what the permutation does over there. But on the left-hand side, the top will be mapped to the next one, repeat, 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 repeat. And so what I get out of this is that every vertex of B is adjacent to every vertex of B prime. Okay? Does that make sense? It's not really hard. But this is the key observation, that between two blocks of script B contained in different blocks of E, there is either no edge or every edge. And if I'm doing this basically the graph setup, if you want to do it with directed edges, the exact same argument works. It's just you have directed things going there. And I didn't want to mess with that the first time. So. All right, so now using this, what I will do is show you that if you pick an element that's contained that fixes each block stepwise, then its restriction to a block of script E is in fact a monomorphism. So what I'll do is I'll pick an element G in the fixer. I'll pick an edge. One of two things happens. When I pick my edge, either both endpoints are contained in some block of script E or not. I'll consider the two cases separately. The first case is that what both endpoints of E are contained in some block E prime of E. Now, what do I want? I want to look at G restricted to E, right? One of two things will happen. E and E prime will be the same, or they will not be the same. If they are the same, so if E and E prime are the same, then what? G restricted to E is just G of E. Yeah? Because remember this restriction on E, what does it do? It just acts like G. So if both endpoints are in the same block, then of course it's an automorphism. The change is elsewhere. Otherwise,
What happens is my edge is between two different blocks of E. So this edge has one endpoint in a block of B, one endpoint in a block of B prime. And by my previous argument, I know that there's a complete bipartite graph between those two blocks. So I have every edge between B and B prime. So again, nothing can go wrong when I look at the restriction, because I either have every edge between two blocks of B, or I don't have any edges. In that case, I can anything that just fixes the block here, fixes the block there, will preserve the edges. Okay, so here, G restricted to E is an edge, and G restricted to E is an off gamma because I've considered every edge. They have to have both endpoints in a block of script E or not. That's the end of the proof. Does it make sense? So basically, the picture is the heart of it. Once you have that outside blocks of script E, you have every edge or no edge. Once you have that, life is straightforward, I would say. One thing that might sort of help your intuition here is if you go back to this picture, what would happen if script E and script B are exactly the same? I.e., what, this big block here is actually just this picture there. That would tell us between any two blocks, we always have either every edge or no edge. And we've seen such a beast before. It was the reed product. So in some sense, what's going on here is the idea behind this is that this is a generalization of the reed product. You don't necessarily get a reed product because the edges that are contained in here, which we don't know anything about at all, they may stop it from being a reed product. But outside of these big blocks, if you remove all the edges in here, then we would have a reed product. And that's what this corollary is about. Later on, we're going to be looking at the isomorphism problem for ZP cross ZP, for ZP squared, and for ZP cubed. So let's see what this lemma tells us in the cases that we're going to look at. So I'm going to let P and Q be prime, not necessarily distinct. Gamma vertex transitive digraph of order QP. And G, a subgroup of the automorphism group B transitive, to have a normal complete block system with blocks inside of P. So basically, the hypothesis is set up so that I only have two primes, and the hypothesis of the lemma is satisfied, the previous lemma. What do we get to conclude? Well, one of two things happens. We've already sort of talked about if there's more than one equivalence class, if script D and script B are the same, we actually get a reed product. That's actually the second one. The other one is that a Celo P subgroup of the fixer has to have order P. One of two things happens. Fixer has order P, or the graph is a reed product. And of course, the graph that you're going to be reading, one is going to be the quotient. The other one, this notation here, is the subgraph of gamma induced by B. So just look at what was inside one of those big E's, which actually isn't big. All right, so there is some argument that has to be done here. So first off, let's look at what happens if, script D, what are the possibilities for number of blocks and sizes of blocks, or how many equivalence classes? Let's rephrase that. Is it clear we can have one equivalence class? It's the whole set. That's certainly a possibility. What's the only other possibility? What? The script E comes from a block system in the quotient.
Right? Y'all with me? It's an equivalence relation on the blocks. It's a G congruence. So those give you blocks. Those blocks are actually in the quotient. Our quotient is of degree Q because I've got blocks of size P. So there's only two choices. I'm going to have one equivalence class, in which case script E is just one block, or the other case is that there are Q equivalence classes. So here I'm sort of considering the first case. I've got one equivalence class, so I've got one block of size Q. Alright, the first thing that I'd like to show you is that if you look at the restriction homomorphism into the symmetric group on a block, that the kernel must be trivial. Alright, so let's unpack this a little bit. I'm looking at the restriction homomorphism. The kernel, everybody knows, of course, the kernel is everything that gets mapped to the identity. So what's the kernel going to look like? It's going to look at everything that's the identity on the block I'm looking at, and then maybe it does something somewhere else. Does it make sense? So this kernel, it's the identity on B, and maybe it does other things. I'm going to claim that no, it can't do anything else. Okay. So, well, what happens if it does do something else? Then there's something else. Now, we haven't really used the fact that it's prime yet, not much. And this is really where you can see where the prime bit comes in. Because what? If you have a transitive group of prime degree, it is necessarily primitive. Yeah? So, what? As it's primitive, oh goodness, okay, he knows. So, we know that the action on a block is primitive. The kernel is a normal subgroup. So, if it's the identity on one block, but it does something else over here, this is normal. A normal subgroup of a primitive group is transitive. That was another one of the results that we have. So because we have prime, we know primitive, that means that in this kernel, fix one block, do something, anything other than the identity on another block, you know that it blows up to be transitive. And as P is prime, that means that you have to have an element of order P, which is a P cycle. So there is a normal subgroup of a primitive group is transitive. K in its action on B prime is transitive. It fixes every point in B otherwise. B prime has order P, so P divides K. And that means that on this other block where it does something, you can find a P cycle. So what we've got is that all the points are fixed in one block, it's a P cycle on the other, and this means that those two blocks are not related by our equivalence relation. So B is not equivalent to B prime. I'm not in the case where I have one equivalence class, I have more than one, and that's a contradiction, so that the CLOP subgroup in fact has order. This is the part we talked about actually already. This is sort of the, I think, the easier one to see what goes on. If we don't have one block of size QP, the only other possibility, because what the equivalence classes form a block of quotient, it's just one or Q. We did Q before, so it's just one. That means that what? There's one block in each equivalence class. So script E and script P are the same. And just recall that the Reith product, we have either no edges between copies of gamma 2 or every edge between copies of gamma 2. That's exactly what happens. So it's going to be a Reith product.
Did you know why I'm going to restrict myself to the case of a product of two primes when I do the proofs later? It's because if you have three primes, then this is not true. And that's actually a lot more complicated. So, it's not the case that if you have nice blocks of size P of prime, then it necessarily has order P or breaks down into a wreath product. When you get to P cubed, there are three choices, right? Let's just say we had P cubed, then the quotient has degree P squared, so the possibilities for the number of equivalence classes is 1, P or P squared. 1 will give you this fixer as order P, everything's great. P squared will give you a wreath product, everything's great. But P, then we really have something different has to be done, more complicated. But you always have to deal with the case where the kernel has order P and you get a wreath product. So this is sort of the simplest cases that we'll be looking at. All right.
Sorry, but in that case, is this true? And
yes.
Is it proved in a more complicated way, or is it not true at all?
Yes.
It's true?
It's true.
Except when it's not. It depends on the values of P and Q.
Oh.
So for square free n, you can make it CI, because the things are relatively prime, you can go through and make the proof work. If you go to P cubed, if you're looking at ZP cubed and you run into that situation, some of the time you're going to be able to finish it. It depends on what happens then in the quotient. If the quotient turns out to be just a cyclic group of order P squared, it doesn't work. It's not CI. But if you go to ZP cross ZP cross ZP, then it does work. So when I say it gets more complicated, and it really does get more complicated, and that's why I'm not really going to get to it, and I don't have time. The arguments, ZP cross ZP takes about a page. I think ZP cross ZP took about 10, and ZP cross ZP cross ZP cross ZP took, okay, there's a cheating 10-page proof in the literature, but I said cheating because it uses a lot more. Each time you add a prime, it gets much more complicated, and as Misha mentioned yesterday, nobody has been able to sort out ZP cross ZP cross ZP cross ZP cross ZP, except when P is 2 and P is 3 via computers. Okay, so as you add a prime divisor to the order of the graph, the complexity, it doesn't go up proportionally, it gets a lot. Okay, I have one last thing to tell you about before we start in on the proof. We'll do ZP cross ZP first. I have a tendency to think it's the easiest, although maybe it wasn't the first one we done. So here's the trick. Suppose you have a Cayley graph of G. It's going to be a CI digraph of G if and only if its image under a group automorphism of G is also going to be a CI digraph. Okay, so G is a, so another way of phrasing this is that a CI digraph is invariant under automorphisms of G. It's still a CI digraph. I've got a proof here, and I was reading this morning. I actually do sort of prepare for these things, and I couldn't actually tell the difference between the two proofs and panicked because I thought they were both the same, and it occurred to me that there's a lot of blabbing up there, there's a lot of symbols. Let me just draw you the picture. And I think you'll go, okay, this is dull. Both of the pictures are almost exactly the same, which is why if you read through the proof,
what? This is an if and only if, so we do one direction and the other. They're very, very similar. So let's just do the first direction. That. So let's let gamma be Kaylee GS. Let's let gamma prime equal Kaylee G alpha of S. And one thing I probably do need to mention is that lemma 4 gives us that the image of a Kaylee graph under a group automorphism is still a Kaylee graph. Okay, so let's assume that gamma is CI. So here's the great picture. Suppose that you pick some other Kaylee graph of G that's isomorphic to the image. What I want to show is that gamma and gamma prime, gamma double prime, are isomorphic by a group automorphism. Okay? Now, what about gamma? It's CI. Is gamma actually isomorphic to gamma prime? The answer, of course, is yes, because you can just follow alpha over here, and whatever this map is, you can just follow it down. So gamma and gamma prime, double prime, are isomorphic, but gamma is CI, so there has to be beta in aught G that's also, that's a letter. There has to be some beta in the automorphism group of G, which maps gamma to gamma double prime. And now, if you want to get from gamma prime to gamma double prime by an automorphism, well, what do? You just go backwards here and then down there. And automorphism group is a group. The other direction basically works just the same. It's just, I think, you have to draw the picture backwards, or the mirror image. Is that okay? It works pretty much exactly the same. I find this to be very useful. That's why I called it a useful trick. All right. So there's our useful trick. So let's show that CG cross ZP is a CI group with respect to diagrams. And I think this is done by Godsell, 1983. So let's let P be a prime. There's our goal. We want to show that CP cross CP is a CI group with respect to diagrams. So we're going to pick ourselves a Kaylee diagram in CP cross ZP. We'll pick a delta in the symmetric group on ZP squared, such that delta inverse ZP squared L delta is contained in the automorphism group. Let me remind you what that really means is that the image delta gamma is a Kaylee digraph of ZP squared isomorphic to gamma. We're setting things up so that we can apply lemma 23. There's lemma 23. So we pick a delta in SG such that delta inverse GL delta is contained in the automorphism group of gamma. We need to find a gamma in the automorphism group of the original digraph such that gamma inverse GL delta gamma is GL. And remember that what was going on here was this delta gamma, where that comes from is delta's our original automorphism. Delta gamma is just picking a different automorphism by applying, picking a different isomorphism by applying an automorphism of the original digraph first. Okay, so we're going to conjugate, unless we don't. So
We wish to show the delta inverse ZP squared L delta and ZP squared L are conjugate in log gamma.
I'm sort of lying to you because I will not show that, because if I happen to stumble across a group automorphism as an isomorphism, I will stop. Okay? And sometimes that happens. Now, typically, with the group theoretic approach, what you want to first do is try to get yourself some blocks. So what we try to do is show that we can assume that this is in primitive, that we've got some blocks. Okay? How do we do that? We also want to remember that this group we can replace by a conjugate if we need to. In this particular case, finding blocks is actually easy. Because what? This is a P subgroup, so its conjugate is a P subgroup. So they're contained in C low P subgroups, P1 and P2, of the automorphism group. And so I can conjugate P2 to get back to P1. And then this guy and the new conjugate are both contained in P1. Everybody with me? I'm just applying Celo theorems to get the original, the left regular representation, together with a conjugate of the conjugate in the same Celo P subgroup. Okay. And why does this do the job for me? I'm going to prove that this does the job for me. It gives me blocks of size P, but I'm going to do it in a much more general form because the proof is identical. So here it is. A transitive P group has a normal complete block system with blocks of size P all the time. So if you go back to the previous slide, I have them in a P group. This P group is transitive because it contains two transitive subgroups, or at least one transitive subgroup. So it's transitive. All right, this is not hard. It's actually really easy. How do you do it? P groups, what do we know? Non-trivial center, yeah? That means there's something in the center. And that means I can choose an element of order P from the center. Then it's normal in G because it's in the center. The subgroup generated by this element chosen, element of order P chosen from the center, would be normal, and that gives you its form of complete block systems. The blocks are non-trivial because I chose a non-trivial element, so boom, I get blocks, normal blocks of size P, and I'm done. One nice thing about this is that if you were dealing in the prime power case, so far, the argument is exactly the same. And not only would you have blocks of size P, but then you could modify the blocks, apply the argument in the quotient, you'll get blocks of size P squared. Quotient by those, apply the argument, you'll get blocks of size P cubed. So you have this nice nested layer of blocks. So P groups with blocks are really, really, really nice. Okay. So what I'm going to assume, without loss of generality, is that my original delta is a P group and that it has blocks of size P. So one of the things I have a tendency to do is that if I would have called this thing I conjugated by the appropriate thing, I would have given it a subscript because I'm going to conjugate again. What I do is, after I conjugate, I just assume that the one I started with has that property, just because the notation turns out to be a nightmare, and I can't write it correctly. All right. This tells me something nice. Script P is also, then, a complete block system of ZP squared L by lemma 40. What is lemma 40? So G is an abelian group, then what? Any complete block system is formed by the orbits of some subgroups. So is it clear that if it's a, so I guess the first thing, is it clear that I went from a group bigger than ZPL, right? Is it clear that any block system of the big group is a block system of the little group?
And then we get that there, then we apply. So let me go back. 40, it's going to have to be a complete block system in ZP squared L. And by level 40, this latter group has P plus 1 different complete block systems of order P. I left that out. One for each normal subgroup of order P.
So I left a little bit out there that would be a little better. But I have blocks of size P. I know that they're also blocks of ZP squared L. And I know that the blocks of ZP squared L come from the order of the normal subgroup.
So to figure out how many different complete block systems I might have that I might be looking at, I just need to think about the complete block systems of ZP squared L. Now I claim that there are P plus 1 different subgroups of order P. So let me verify that for you. One for each normal subgroup of order P. So I'm going to be looking at the subgroups of order P. I've got this little computation here. You have two subgroups of order P. If they're different, what is their intersection? It's trivial. That's where the 1 comes from. That 1 is counting the identity. Now, these two subgroups, if they intersect in the identity, that means that each one of them contains P minus 1 elements that are not contained in any other one. Right? And so that's where this P minus 1 comes from, because these are the non-identity elements in each subgroup of order P. And if you have P plus 1 of them, you get the correct number of vertices. So this is one of these cases where I've cheated. Really, you should have an x there and then solve for x, and that would tell you the number. I went ahead and solved when I got P plus 1.
Okay, so I guess the point is that if I had a cyclic group where I have a unique subgroup of order P, I'd know exactly what my blocks are. Here, I don't know. I've got a block system, but right now I've got no idea what it is, other than it's formed by the orbits of some subgroup of order P, and there are a bunch of those. That's really the whole point, that I got a block system, that's great, but I don't know what it is. Now, why is this a problem? This is a problem because sometime or another, eventually, we're going to have to sit down and get our hands dirty. And we're going to have to do computations. And if you have a natural complete block system, the computations go nice and smoothly. And if you don't, quite frankly, I don't know how to do them, because it's just too weird. Okay, maybe I could do them, but they'll take about, you just don't want to. So the point here is that I've got a block system. Maybe it's the one I like, maybe it isn't. The next thing I want to do is make sure that it's one that I like. Now, if you're thinking, okay, which one should you like? To me, there are actually two that you can choose from. And if we've got ZP cross ZP, y'all with me, it's either the first ZP or the second ZP. You don't want the diagonal subgroup like 1-1, generated by 1-1 or generated by 1-2. You want a subgroup generated by 1-0 or the subgroup generated by 0-1. And which one you choose depends upon which one you like to think of as on top, quite frankly. For me, I like to think of the first coordinate as being on top, the second coordinate, it's cosets forming the block. So for me, the most convenient way for me to do the computations is if this complete block system is formed by the orbits of H hat, I think I called it, and H is 0-1, i.e. the complete block system consists of the cosets of this H. I don't have that. The next thing that I will show you is how to arrange that. And somewhat shockingly, we will use a useful trick to do that. Okay, I think I will stop there because
The useful trick will take a little more than 5 minutes.
So are there any questions? If not, then let us thank the speaker once more.